Hey folks, this is Bogosian. So this screencast is going to be for you folks who did not take Chem 300 or maybe just need a little refresher on chemistry. So the things that we're going to cover in this screencast are we're going to do a really brief review of the periodic table, a little bit about subatomic particles, something called the Octet Rule, and then the basics of chemical bonding. So you've probably seen this table before. This is called the periodic table of elements, and this demonstrates how we keep all of the elements that we have in the world organized. Now, each one of these little squares actually has a pretty sizable amount of information about each different element. So we're going to look at how to read those. So the first element that we're going to look at is going to be this one right here, which is sodium. And there's actually a lot of information contained in this little box right here. So every box has the name of the element written in them in full. And then the box also has a chemical symbol that represents each element, because some of the names are really long, and so it would be really challenging to write them out every single time you wanted to draw a diagram. Then this number down here at the bottom is called the atomic mass, but we really won't use a whole lot of that in biology. The most important piece of information for our purposes is going to be the number in the upper left corner of any of these boxes, and that's called the atomic number, and it's going to tell us a lot about how the element is going to interact with other elements. So this number is going to tell us a lot about how it interacts because it's going to tell us about the numbers of different subatomic particles that are contained within one atom of each element. So let's take a closer look at sodium. So you may remember that there are three different components to atoms, and they are neutrons, protons, and electrons, and each one of them has a different role in making up the atom. So neutrons have no charge, and protons have a positive charge, and both of those are found within the nucleus of the atom. So sodium has an atomic number of 11, which means that its nucleus would usually contain 11 protons and 11 neutrons, so it looked kind of like this. So this cluster of neutrons and protons is what we call the nucleus of the atom. Electrons are also a key part of the atom because they have a negative charge, but they are not contained within the nucleus. So most of the time, sodium is going to have 11 electrons, and they're arranged in layers around the outside of the nucleus. So each of these layers is called an orbital, and this first layer is called the s orbital, and it can hold 2 electrons. However, sodium doesn't only have 2 electrons, it has 11 electrons, and so we're going to need to find a place to put the rest of those electrons. And so we're going to add another orbital around the outside like this. And this orbital is going to be called the p orbital. This second orbital or shell of electrons can actually hold 8 electrons. So far we held 2 in the first layer and then another 8 in the second layer, which is a total of 10. But sodium still has 11 electrons, and so we need to find a place to put the final one. So our outermost shell is going to contain that final electron. So far, we have diagrammed all of our neutrons, our protons, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 electrons in 3 layers. And what's going to be the most important is going to be this layer, the outermost layer, because the outermost orbital of electrons is going to enable the atom to interact with other atoms. So let's go back to our periodic table for a minute. So here's sodium right here. And if we remember, it had 1 electron in the outermost shell. We call this outermost electron a valence electron. And actually, everything else that's in this column right here also has 1 valence electron. So hydrogen, lithium, sodium, potassium, all the way down in that column, they all have 1 valence electron. So now we're back to our sodium atom. It has 1 valence electron, but it has 7 empty spaces in this shell. So one here, 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 and here. It really wants to have 8 electrons in its outermost shell, and we call this the octet rule. So in order to satisfy the octet rule, this sodium atom now has 2 options. It could get rid of this electron right here and thus have 8 electrons in this outer shell. Or, if it didn't want to do that, and decided it wanted to do something else, it could actually try to acquire 7 other electrons to fill all of these spaces right here. Now, one of these options is going to require a pretty small amount of effort. The other option would require a lot of effort. And so let's take an educated guess as to which one is probably going to be chosen by this sodium atom. So if you guess that it's probably going to want to jettison this electron right here in order to satisfy the octet rule, you are correct. And this is exactly what's going to happen. It's going to get rid of this electron right here. So let's figure out what the impact of jettisoning this electron would be. And let's figure out what the charge of this atom is before we start. So because neutrons have a zero charge, we don't have to worry about them. Let's just count up the number of protons and electrons. Currently, we have 11 protons, and each one of them has a charge of positive 1. We also have 11 electrons, and each one of them has a charge of negative 1, which means that our positive and negative charges in this atom currently balance each other out perfectly, and so we have a net charge of 0. This atom is really unhappy in this state, however, because it doesn't have a full outer shell. It hasn't satisfied the octet rule in its current form. Let's see what happens if we put this sodium atom in the same vicinity as a chlorine atom. Now, if you look at these two atoms that we have drawn here, you'll notice that they look almost exactly the same. There's nothing special about each one of these. The only thing that's different is the number of neutrons, protons, and electrons that each one has. Sodium has an atomic number of 11, and chlorine has an atomic number of 17. At the moment, this means that it will have 17 neutrons, 17 protons, and 17 electrons. And since the protons and electrons balance one another out, the chlorine atom will also have a charge of 0. The chlorine atom also currently has an empty space in its outermost valence electron shell. Just like the sodium atom, it does not satisfy the octet rule. It's going to be much easier for a chlorine atom to gain one electron in order to fill its outer shell than it would be for it to lose 7 electrons. And so that's why you oftentimes see sodium and chlorine bonded together. An electron will be transferred over from the sodium atom to the outermost shell of the chlorine atom like this. And now, both atoms will have a filled outer shell. The process doesn't stop here, however, so let's go back to our sodium atom and tally up neutrons, protons, and electrons. If I look at my sodium atom now, I still have the same number of neutrons and protons, but I'm now missing an electron. So let me change the number that's up here like this. So I now only have 10 electrons, each with a charge of minus 1, which means that I actually have more positive charges than I have negative charges, and so my final charge is going to be positive 1. Now go over to the chlorine atom and see if you can figure out what the charge of the chlorine atom would be. Remember to count up the total number of neutrons, protons, and electrons. If you counted right, you'll notice that you now have an extra electron in the chlorine atom. You have 18 negative 1 charges, and you only have 17 positive charges, which means that the chlorine atom would have an overall charge of minus 1. After the transfer of the electrons, the sodium atom has a positive charge and the chlorine atom has a negative charge. Because the charges are opposite to one another, these two atoms will attract one another, and they'll stick together kind of like magnets. We call this an ionic bond. This molecule of sodium chloride formed by the ionic bond is actually something that you're probably familiar with. This NaCl is actually the chemical formula for table salt. Now let's go back to the periodic table and see if we can figure out which columns tend to form ionic bonds. Because ionic bonds involve a transfer of just a couple of electrons, we tend to see them happening in this column over here on the left, right here, and then we tend to see them happening in this column that's second from the right over here. So elements that are in this column on the left, they need to only lose one electron. And these atoms over here on the right, they need to gain one electron. Because they satisfy the octet rule in different ways, these two element columns tend to combine with one another pretty frequently and form ionic bonds. However, we don't see much bonding action happening in this column that's farthest on the right. Take a look at the number of valence electrons that each of these elements has and see if you can figure out why. These elements are actually called inert or noble gases. They already have a full electron outer shell, and so they don't need to form any more bonds in order to satisfy the octet rule. Because of this, they don't tend to form bonds. So now we know that we tend to form ionic bonds with elements that are on opposite sides of the periodic table. But what about these elements that are in here? It'd be a lot of work in order to lose or gain 4 or 3 or even 2 valence electrons, and so they wind up doing something a little bit different. So let's take a look at carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen, just like we're going to do in class. Let's start with our friend carbon. Take a look at its atomic number and see if you can figure out how many valence electrons it would have. If you determined that carbon has 2 electrons in its first orbital, and then another 4 in the second orbital, then you're correct. Unfortunately, because it only has 4 electrons in its outermost shell, carbon isn't even close to satisfying the octet rule. But it would take a huge amount of effort in order to gain or lose 4 electrons in order to satisfy the octet rule. So here's what carbon does instead. Carbon engages in what is called covalent bonding, where it shares electrons with other atoms instead of transferring them. Hydrogen also has 1 valence electron, and it needs one more in order to satisfy its octet rule. And so frequently you see carbon and hydrogen bonded together. So the two of them will actually share 1 set of electrons. And in order to fill the outermost shell of this carbon atom, we're going to need to add on 4 hydrogen atoms. Now that we've bonded together 1 carbon atom and 4 hydrogen atoms, both the hydrogen atoms and the carbon atoms are satisfied in terms of the number of valence electrons. Hydrogen has a full outer shell with 2 electrons, because it only has 1 shell of electrons in total, and then carbon's outer shell is also full with 8 electrons. This molecule that we've created is CH4, also known as methane, or the gas that you produce when you fart. A molecule like oxygen has 6 valence electrons, and so you're going to find that it will form 2 bonds with other atoms. So you might wind up with an atom that looks like this, and an atom that looks like that, attaching to this oxygen, and forming a compound that we're very familiar with, which is H2O. Both the hydrogen and the oxygen now have a complete outermost shell of electrons. Nitrogen can form 3 covalent bonds because it has 3 spaces to share. 1, 2, and 3. And so a hydrogen might, in theory, attach to each of these attachment points and share an electron with nitrogen in order to complete its outer octet. This compound, NH3, is also known as ammonia, which is a very powerful cleaning product. Coming back to our periodic table, remember that you have ionic compounds that tend to form with elements on either extreme of the periodic table, and you tend to have covalent bonds forming with elements that are in the middle of the periodic table. Hydrogen is the interesting swinger because it can do both. However, most of the time in biology we'll be discussing covalent bonding because that's what atoms such as carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur tend to do. Okay, so that's pretty much chemistry in a nutshell. Thanks for watching, everybody.